What's up, everyone? It's Preston here from PG Custom Woodworks. Just thought I'd make a little video on how to make an ingrain cutting board. A little disclaimer, if you plan on using Paduke and or Purple Heart in any of your ingrain cutting boards, just remember that once you finish it, it actually turns a lot darker and the colors aren't as vibrant as they are on the side grain. Never used those two combination of woods in an ingrain cutting board before, and I found this out the hard way, but nonetheless, just keep that in mind. So here I am, I'm just kind of looking at what I have off the shelf, just some scraps I had laying around. Want to make sure that the pattern I'm going for, I have enough wood, and I won't have any issues later on. So just kind of measure what you got. You know you're going to make a few cuts, just keep that in mind, keep the thickness of the blade in mind. And here I am just drawing the pattern, so I use a combination of maple, purple heart, and Paduke. Just run them over the joiner a few times, get your edges nice and square. I think I went with a 2-inch and a 1-inch strip of each wood, with the exception of the maple, which is 4 inches, I believe. So go ahead and just run everything through the planer. You'll notice I'm putting a piece in first and then last. That's to prevent any type of snipe. Kind of use it as like a sacrificial piece, so to speak. So once you get all the edges nice and square, laying down the same thickness, just go ahead and throw your pattern together. Found a website, which I'll post a link in the description, you can actually use to see what your cutting board would look like if you use a certain array of patterns once you flip every other piece. So, like I said, I'll post that down in the description. And here I am gluing the pieces together, everyone's favorite part, I'm sure. There's a couple of different ways to do it. You can see me, I'm just using my fingers, probably the messiest way, but nonetheless, get the job done. There are some rollers out there and even some silicone brushes you can use, but I used pieces on the end to prevent any type of clamp marks, just some sacrificial pieces, and also make sure you clamp the end nice and tight so they're all on the same level. Here's what the panel looks like, all glued up. I usually let my panels sit for about anywhere between 12 to 24 hours before I take them out of the clamps. It's probably a little overkill, but it's just kind of the way I like to do it. So, before I run it through the planer, I like to get all the excess glue off so you can take a chisel and or a hand plane and get everything nice and flush. The calls, when you clamp it up, usually do a pretty good job of posting it just in case. So run it through the planer, both one side and flip it over to the other side so you have a nice even surface. Once you take it out of the clamps, you get everything nice and plain. Make sure you trim the edges, that way you'll get a nice and clean cut. I think I used an inch and a half for my strips, which would be the cutting board. Once you glue it on the end grain, will be about an inch and a half thick starting out before you plane everything. Keep that in mind, depending on how thick you want your cutting board, that's how wide you'll need to cut your strips on this side. Alright, so once you get all your strips cut, flip them on the end grain. Now comes the fun part, rotate every other piece to kind of see what pattern you're going for. Kind of like this little pattern, it's kind of a little effect. You see me actually doing some strips of pine on them. What that's going to do is whenever you run it through the planer, usually the end kind of likes to chip out, so this will actually prevent the expensive wood from chipping out, and the pine strips will take the brunt of it. So make sure your patterns align nice and properly before you tighten it down. I usually like to go a little bit at a time on each clamp. That way it prevents any patterns from being off. So again, set it aside and let it dry. You're basically going to repeat the same process as you did once you glued the strips together to form a side grain panel. You just basically get the excess glue off. Make sure everything's nice and flush. That way, once you run through the planer, it's not that big a deal. I know some people are kind of hesitant to run an ingrain piece through a planer, but if you take it nice and slow and just take very small passes, or very light passes, I should say, it's usually not that big a deal. So just go ahead and trim up the edges to get them nice and square, and then here I am just cutting off the sacrificial pieces on the ends. Now comes the fun part, everybody's favorite time, sanding. I did a lot of sanding. Started out with 80 grit and went all the way up to 350. So just make sure with the ingrain cutting board you run through your grits. It definitely makes a difference in the end result. I like to round over my edges on both sides of my cutting boards. I think this is a half inch round over bit. So I just ran over all four sides, top and bottom. And a little more hand sanding just to get some of the smaller burn marks off left by the router. The finish. I use just a mineral oil finish. It's food safe. And this is when I realized that the Purple Heart and Duke weren't going to be as bright and have a pop to them once finished. So a little disappointed, but it's a little too late now. So I let it sit for about 4 hours and pulled it out and just let it air dry, kind of drip dry. Once it's all done dripping, just go ahead and take some paper towels or a cloth and just wipe off all the excess. And you can see here how dark the Purple Heart and Duke turned out. But nonetheless, it's still a pretty cool little design, I think. In the sun, you can kind of tell a little bit of a difference, but still not as bright as I would have liked them to be. So there you have it. That's how I make my ingrain cutting boards. Hope you enjoyed the video. Don't forget to subscribe. Thanks.